Very few New Zealand plays ever get restaged. But next week, 25 years since it was first performed, Oscar Kightley's Dawn Raids will take to the stage once again. For Kightley, it's an opportunity to reflect on the place of the Dawn Raids in our history, the significance of the government's official apology, and progress that has and hasn't been achieved. At the same time, Kightley is pursuing another career. The playwright wants to be a local body politician. I want to start with the contrast. Take me back 25 years.
Oh.
If you can. What was the New Zealand attitude to the Dawn Raids at the time you penned this play?
Forget about it. There was none, because no one talked about it. And it was something that happened in the 70s that maybe bled into the 80s, but it was part of our history, like so much of New Zealand history. It's like it's happened. No one was doing stuff about it. There was no docos about it. There was no social media for a start. There was no, and I thought actually by writing something on the Dawn Raids and putting it out there in the form of a play that maybe that would start discussion, because it seemed like such a heavy thing to have happened in our recent past, and no one talked about it, and so I thought maybe the play might do that, but it didn't.
Really?
Nah, we had one doing publicity for it, you know, we talked about it, but there was no kind of thing after. And this play, which we performed at the end of the 1900s, it's only been done twice. The first season in Auckland, and then we did a season in Christchurch the year later. So the fact that it's coming back 25 years later, maybe at a time when New Zealand is ready to talk about it. You know, there's been the apology. There was the Panthers series recently. There has been more awareness, I think, from young people. And also a general waking upness socially and politically. So maybe now, but it feels like back then people thought it was a work of fiction.
Yeah.
You know, that these dramatic Samoan actors were just putting something dramatic on.
Right.
But there was no attitude towards it. There was no one discussing it. There was no one feeling bad about it. There were no politicians. It was something that the Pacific community, Samoan, Tonga and Fiji mainly, because we were the ones who were deported, we just had to deal with it on our own as a bad memory that we just had to put to the past, and that's why I wanted to write it.
Okay, talk to me a bit more about that. So there's basically no prominence when it comes to New Zealand society at large, but just how prominent were the Dawn Raids in your life and the experience of your community?
Huge, because I was 4 when I arrived in this country and they were on. And even though I was only a little kid, I'd heard about them at the time. It was just this really yuck thing that was happening that was affecting the air outside your house, that affected the attitude towards you from non-Samoans, non-Pacific people. So we knew about it. When we tried to ask our parents about it, they wouldn't want to talk about it. You know, because they came here wanting to add to this country and contribute, and bringing up something so awful seems like being a bad guest, you know. But this, you know, now we're more than guests. We're part of the population. We're part of the landscape. Part of the country. And maybe only now is the time when, you know, with the apology a couple of years ago, maybe only this is when all that stuff had to happen. You know, now New Zealand history is going to be taught in schools, including the Dawn Raids. They weren't even teaching Māori history. They weren't even teaching about the New Zealand wars back then. So I feel like the renaissance, I think, I hope it's a renaissance, but the increasing of awareness towards tangata whenua and the past and things that needed to be discussed and righted, I think that has actually helped shed light on things that happened to other communities as well.
Renaissance is a fancy word. You called it waking upness first, which I really like. What role have you played in that?
No matter what's been going on in New Zealand, I feel like we've always had artists who contributed, who talked about things. And even the 90s, which politically was such a weird time, I feel like the first half of the 90s, the country was getting over Rogernomics and adjusting itself. And that weird 90s national government, it was kind of strange. There was no supports for the arts, but there were still artists, there were still great companies making work. I only learnt about Samoa's struggle for freedom from New Zealand as a 21-year-old when I read the book And I was like, what? What does this happen? And so that kind of put me on a you know, in terms of knowing about New Zealand's colonial history with Samoa and then this. So I was an angry young man, very sensitive, very intense, and I wanted to shake, you know, me and all my friends and all in our company. We wanted to tell stories about us growing up. Because I felt like we were invisible. This was before all the stuff that we now take for granted. You know, the internet had only just started 2 years earlier. This was before all that stuff. And we wanted to make a noise. We wanted to say, we are here. We're part of this country. And these are some of the things that would do you well to know as well.
What did you think of the apology?
It was important. I was there. It had to happen.
How did it feel, hearing those words, watching that scene play out?
It was emotional. It was quite beautiful, and especially the symbolic way they did it, you know, with the ifonga, with the fine mat being placed over the Prime Minister. And in the moment that you picked it up and lifted, that was, we accepted it. Whether you accept it personally or not, it didn't matter. In that moment where he lifted that offer, that was the Samoan community going, okay, we accept your apology. But they were so insidious and they had such a horrible effect that still carry on now. They were such extraordinary times that I think an apology requires extraordinary compensation. It's like we felt really bad that this happened. You know, it's not just, oh, we said sorry and acknowledged it. It should have been, there should have been pathways for overstayers at the moment, Pacific overstayers at the moment who've been living in fear for years. There should be pathways for them to, as a recognition, you know. There should be easier pathways for Pacific people. You know, we've got a worker and people shortage. Pacific's like the, you know, it's like the last place we look to. There's people right in our backyard, baristas, you know, lawyers, doctors. We just go, oh, fruit pickers. It's like the last thing. It's like, okay, we'll get, let some in to pick fruit, you know, but, and it's been a real boon for our agriculture industry and also for the villagers that take part. But I feel like there should have been extraordinary compensation because there were extraordinary times, and I would have liked to have seen that, not just $1 million for young people to learn about the raids, you know. It needed to, so that people who didn't think they were a big deal actually sat up and went, oh shit, well, if the government's doing this, you know, actually, what was that about? You know, what was the horrible things that happened?
When I think about your work, there are some interesting contrasts. And a lot of your work over the years has used humour really effectively. And it's interesting to contrast a play like Dawn Raids with something like Bro Town or Sione's Wedding. And I wonder if you have found humour to be a more effective vehicle in kind of subtly getting your message to a big audience.
Yeah, totally.
Sweet, good.
And Dawn Raid was a part of that because it was, I spent a year working on it. It was meant so much to me. It was really for older Pacific Islanders. That's the audience I wanted, and also young ones, to kind of tell them what happened. And I was really quite intense, and just got one bad review, Jack. And it just about ended me. I couldn't write for a year, I almost gave up. But actually I changed my approach after that. I was like, man, Pākehās kind of don't like hearing this stuff when you're kind of presented on stages as truth. But Dawn Raids is still a very funny play.
Yeah.
That was just me. But yeah, after that it was like, man, stuff doing the serious stuff that people might get the wrong idea about. I'm going to do comedy. But the comedy ended up about serious stuff.
Yeah.
You know, it wasn't like, I'm going to do comedy about nothing that matters. I just want to make people laugh. It was, you know.
Did you ever worry that your comedy might overstep a line and you might do damage to your communities? Did you ever worry about things like stereotyping or characters that might end up having some sort of a negative impact on your community?
I didn't really, because that whole thing about stereotyping came from others. They look at your work and they add the label stereotype. I look at the work and I see characters that I knew and played that we developed from real people we knew and lives we knew. Other people look and go, oh, stereotype.
Yeah.
And I don't accept that. So just because someone calls your stuff stereotyped or whatever, if that's not the place that you come from, you know, it's not like... It's not like I'm not of the community where, like, someone like Chris Lilly.
Yeah, right.
You know, I hate to bag other artists.
No, no, I get it.
But he's a Pākehā Australian doing something like Jonah from Tonga. And that's obviously coming from outside that world, whereas if a Tongan did that show, you know, it would have, I think, more.
Yeah.
And I feel like I'm telling stories about things and people I know, and one way to shut those stories down is to throw the labels like stereotype at it and to try and dismiss it in that way. So I've never worried about damaging my community because that's not why I do it. Yeah, I hate that. It's kind of a real thing. It's like I can't talk about Brotown now without
like
somebody
that?
Saying, oh, but didn't it do this and didn't it do that? And it's like, well,
for
it was like
worth,
Billy T. Sorry, if I.
Yeah, sorry.
It was like Billy T. I remember him saying, never compare any of us to the great Billy T. I remember seeing him in an interview saying he was hurt at when people said that his characters were stereotypes because to him, they were people he knew. You know, the sheep shearer with the singlet. That wasn't. He didn't sit in a room and go, I know, I'll do a Māori sheep shearer and make him talk like this. He was playing characters. Yeah. We'd never seen those characters before on screen.
I guess I just wondered if it was a tension that you are aware of as a writer and as an artist.
I'm aware of it because I always get asked about it.
Sorry.
And I hate having to defend it because I don't think other artists get asked the same thing. You know, why can't Samoans write plays about characters that are real people? Why do non-Samoans go, oh, you're stereotyping? You know what I mean? It's, everyone can watch Godfather and know that not all Italian Americans are in the mafia.
Yeah.
Why does our stuff have to be a documentary that has to reflect true life, that has to reflect absolutely every aspect of our community? They're just stories. Dawn Raids is a play about this one family's response to the Dawn Raids. Brotown was about a group of teenage friends, 14-year-olds growing up in the city, being surrounded by less than ideal adults and role models, but still finding a life through it, you know? And, you know, I am aware of it. I totally reject it. And it annoys me that our stories get that sort of pressure on them, you know? It's the same with, I think, Māori stuff. Sometimes things can't just exist in itself.
Yeah, right.
You know, no one watches Simpsons and goes, oh, Americans from that part of America aren't all simple folk. No one thinks that.
Yeah.
It's about this family called the Simpsons.
Yeah.
And I hate that our stuff gets that lens applied to it, and that it can't just exist as a story about these characters. Oh, here's another story about these characters. Oh, here's another story.
Yeah.
It's like we make one thing and it has to somehow represent all of us when it can't possibly do that.
Where does that criticism come from?
I don't know. I've never thought about that. I think it's... I don't know. You'd have to ask the people that do that kind of criticising, because it's not for me to figure out where their criticism comes from. I can hazard a guess and say, well, it's because they're from outside the community, they see it through surface, superficial lens, and then they apply that superficial lens to stuff that's a lot deeper and actually seeks to go further than that.
It's interesting that you feel like if you take the... This is too basic a description, but if you take the more serious path in the production of a piece like Dawn Raids, then it struggles to get the cut through historically in the way that you hoped it would. But then if you go down a path for a different kind of story, like Siones or like Brotown or something like that, you perhaps reach a broader audience and it holds a special place for a broader audience, but you still face a criticism that you're not doing
right.
I'm
not trying
to
write for a broad audience.
Yeah.
You know, I don't think of a piece of art and go, I want the broadest possible audience.
Although you do want to change people's minds when it comes to something like Dawn Raids. You do want people to wake up. That was at least part of the original goal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. But you should never homogenise your story. And, you know, I remember I went to this course by this LA script guru, and we were working on a Brotown movie, and I asked him a question. I said, how do you make a local movie, you know, a success globally? And his answer was, you make it as specific as possible to the local culture.
Because it's authenticity, yeah.
Because it's authenticity. If you try and write something that's broad because the author wants you to learn something important, they think, that's another word I hate, important. Come and see this important story. The audience should judge what's important.
Yeah.
You know, I think as artists, all you can do is tell the stories with heart and truth and as much authenticity as you can muster. But also the comedy in Dawn Raids isn't to make it palatable, it's to actually reflect the people too, the characters, you know. We did make jokes about the raids because they were a way of coping. There were some people that rang up and dobbed their relatives in if their niece was or nephew was misbehaving. You know, it was, and in the course of my research I found all this stuff. It wasn't just bad white people oppressed brown people. Who wants to watch that for an hour and a half on stage?
You talked about reparations before, and I wondered about one particular issue when it comes to the Pacific at the moment. We're just starting to see the shoots of conversations around the bleakest of scenarios in climate change. And we interviewed the Tuvalu foreign minister a few weeks ago, and he was telling us how in his country, the conversation is very much moving to a place where they're discussing what nationhood means if they don't have a physical landmass that is inhabitable, what nationhood means if you don't have a nation. And I wondered if you had a position about the role that Aotearoa should play in the coming decades, if indeed we face the worst case scenario when it comes to climate change, and the responsibility that we have to our Pacific.
I think we do have a responsibility. It's interesting with this whole geopolitical struggle over the Pacific. You know, I feel like New Zealand and Australia kind of treated it like a place we still go for holiday. And now that all these big powers are kind of jostling for position over who has more say in it, now we're getting more involved and more concerned, which is, I feel, quite patronising when, like, these are nations, these are sovereign states. Samoa is 3,000 years old, way older than New Zealand. And we treat them like the little kid who needs help with their homework in our backyard. I think New Zealand definitely has a role. You can't colonise as much of the South Pacific as we did. You can't have that relationship with the Cook Islands, with Tokelau, with Niue, a special relationship with Samoa, and then be hands-off when the biggest disaster that is hitting us is unfolding. South Pacific especially, climate change isn't an argument anymore on those islands. And I think New Zealand has a role. And that's an interesting question you raise. And when we get to that part when all of Tuvalu have to leave and resettle in Australia and New Zealand, you know, when there's no physical bit of land, you know, a tūranga waiwai that they can hark back to. I think that's an interesting question, but I think New Zealand has a huge responsibility. We were desperate to be a colonial power. We begged Britain to move in and take over New Zealand from the Germans. We can't pick and choose when we're family, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You're either it means something that we're part of a special neighbourhood. That's why, you know, I think there should be free movement like there is in Europe. I don't know if there ever will be. And I know this damages the islands too, because, you know, a lot of population, if they can come here, they would. You know, you look at Niue's population. But, yeah, I think we do have a massive, and, you know, 60% of the Pasifika population of New Zealand were born here. You know, just through that link alone.
Yeah.
And you've got so many, and you know, my niece is the MP for Mana. You know, there's, the Pacific Caucus is growing. I don't think politically the community would ever let New Zealand not feel that obligation, and whoever's in power.
You're running for local board. Are you a sucker
Henderson
for punishment?
Massey local board. I think I am.
Why do you want to run?
I want to help. I want to serve. Henderson Massey is the area I'm running for. It's got a big Pacific population. It's never had a Pacific Island member. Mm. It's 2022. Mm. I was asked, and I'm always banging on about Pacific people getting involved, voting and standing. So when I was asked, I kind of felt the need to put my body where, you know, I can't just be all talk about it. No time, but it is a part-time job. You know, it shouldn't be a part-time, it shouldn't be a full-time cushy position. It should be a thing that you do in addition, on top of your life you already have to serve your surrounding community. And I've always been interested ever since I was a cadet reporter and got sent to cover council meetings that I thought would be as boring as anything, and weren't. Mm. I was like, wow, these people make these decisions. Mm. That dude in the suit is like, runs the city, yeah. You know? So as a journo, I've learnt a lot about the world and New Zealand, and it was just something that was always in my head, that if I ever did do something, it would be at local government.
That is Oscar Kightley. Dawn Raids opens on the 18th of August at Auckland's ASB Waterfront Theatre. It's being staged by Pacific Underground and Auckland Theatre Company, and you can get tickets at atc.co.nz.